Good morning, everybody. I'm Fotini Sapunzi, and I'm a senior research scientist at Singas Chemove, which is a small medium enterprise located in Eindhoven. It's my pleasure to have the opportunity to present at this summit, and I'm going to speak about our recent work together with the VS Particle and the Dutch Institute for Fundamental Energy Research on the single step fabrication of efficient and stable catalyst coated membranes for electrochemical applications. So I will start with a small introduction on PEM water electrolyzers and the related material challenges. So as also discussed in previous talks, to address the climate change and its long-term multidimensional impacts, the Paris Agreement aims to limit the global temperature increase, and the overall goal is to reach a carbon neutral environment by 2050. And this was also addressed in the COP26 summit a few days ago, which brought parties together to accelerate the actions towards the goals of Paris Agreement. And it is widely agreed that hydrogen will play a pivotal role in this low carbon transition. And it is foreseen that the global hydrogen market will be established in the near future. So this low carbon transition requires far-reaching electrification, of course, powered by renewable electricity. And water electrolysis is expected to play a key role in this transition by storing the excess renewable electricity into chemical energy. Thus, green hydrogen will be used as an energy carrier. And an interesting aspect here is that water electrolysis can not only tackle the hourly and the daily intermittency challenge of renewable energy sources, but also the seasonal intermittency challenge. And this is because water electrolysis can store unlimited amounts of hydrogen over time. But even after reaching far-reaching electrification, we will still be in need for fuels, for example, for aviation, shipping, or heavy road transport, as on the figure. But also we will be in need of chemicals. And the associated production processes for these chemicals and fuels is actually responsible for almost a third of current CO2 emissions. So by implementing water electrolysis in these production processes, can significantly reduce the carbon footprint of chemical industry. So to carry out water electrolysis, there are different technologies available, and each of these technologies has its own operational characteristics, pros and cons, R&D challenges. The problem so far is that the market penetration of water electrolysis is low, and this is because the costs for hydrogen production via water electrolysis are for the moment high. We're speaking about $5 per kilo. And the target, according to the US Department of Energy, is that we have to reach $1 per kilogram of hydrogen in the next decade. And I have here as a reference a nice report of IRENA on scaling up issues of water electrolysis, and it seems that this reduction in cost can be done by following several steps, of course using cheaper electricity which has to be renewable, but also by decreasing the capital costs of electrolyzers, and this means by using cheaper components, but also in the standardization of production. By optimizing the efficiency, and this means actually by reducing the amount of electricity required to produce one unit of hydrogen, but also by increasing durability. And this is because by extending the equipment's lifetime, we can spread the capital cost over longer times of period. So as I said, there are different technologies to carry out water electrolysis, and these are the basics and the fundamentals, and also the main R&D challenge are described thoroughly in this review article, which is open access and was published by Singas Chem a few years ago. But what is common in all cases is that the main elements of water electrolyzers are the two electrodes where the two half reactions take place, and the electrolyte, which is a compound that conducts ions. So now, conventional water electrolysis, industrial water electrolysis for the moment is alkaline water electrolysis, which uses a potassium hydroxide solution as an electrolyte in order to conduct hydroxyl ions from one electrode to the other, while a porous separator, which is called the diaphragm, is used in order to separate and avoid the mixing of hydrogen and oxygen gases. Now, PEM water electrolysis is a more promising technology which has been also recently commercialized. And in this case, a solid polymer membrane is serving as both the electrolyte, so it can transport protons from the one electrode to the other, but at the same time, it serves as a gas separator, so avoiding the mixing of hydrogen and oxygen gases. So since now this polymeric membrane serves both functions, PEM electrolyzers, in comparison with alkaline electrolyzers, can operate with a higher efficiency. So this means that to operate at a standard current density, so this means to produce a certain amount of hydrogen, we now need less potential, less power in order to drive this procedure compared to alkaline electrolysis. And also, as you can see in this figure, PEM electrolyzers have improved load flexibility. And also what I would like to mention is that, and it's also important for upscaling, is that PEM electrolyzers have a more compact reactor design, and also that the operation of PEM electrolysis does not require the circulation of corrosive liquids. So this is also an important aspect in terms of safety. Now, speaking about the performance and efficiency of PEM water electrolyzers, here you can see the different sources of potential losses during PEM electrolysis. And as you can see, the anodic half reaction, which is the oxygen evolution, is the one that the anodic overpotential dominates. The cathodic exists, but it's relatively small and stable. And then you can see the ohmic overpotential, which is increasing linearly with current. And here, actually, you can see two lines for the ohmic overpotential. And this is because the ohmic overpotential can be actually tuned by the thickness of this membrane that we put, that we use. So you can see also here in this figure that by using thinner membranes, the overpotential comes smaller, so actually the efficiency is higher. And this can have an effect of even 200 millivolts. However, ohmic overpotential can be reduced by using thinner membranes, so this is good. But on the other hand, as we said, polymeric membranes serve also a second scope, which is the gas separation. And as you can see here in this figure from literature, the thinner is this membrane, this polymeric membrane, then the crossover of gases through this membrane is just faster or more extended or pronounced. So this is also not beneficial. And so we need actually to find the balance between these two effects. And for this reason, membranes with an intermediate thickness are used in industry. And we chose to use also this kind of membranes in our study to resemble industrial operation. So the state-of-the-art polymeric membrane that is used in water electrolysis is called Nafion. It's a material of DuPont. And this has an acidic nature. So this poses the limitation that PEM water electrolyzers rely on platinum group metals as catalysts. So I will now start the discussion about the cathode of water electrolyzers. Cathode is the compartment where a hydrogen evolution takes place. And this currently relies on platinum. And to address this challenge of reducing actually the capital cost of water electrolyzers in terms of cathode materials, there are two different approaches. The one is that alternative low-cost electrocatalysts, for example, transition metal phosphides, iron phosphides, cobalt phosphides, nickel phosphides, have shown great promise. And here I suggest that you can have a look at our recent publication together with INL and Differ of last year on how iron phosphides can be used under realistic conditions. While there is significant work also from the group of Gasteiger, and this is an alternative approach, and actually it is found that we can even reduce the platinum loadings quite much, but still can sustain sufficient performance. So this means that we can, yeah, maybe still rely on platinum, but we can efficiently use much smaller amounts of platinum to drive electrolysis. However, the challenge of the anode side, which is currently relied on iridium-based electrodes, is very large. Actually, this is the grand challenge of water electrolysis. And why is this? First of all, we don't have any similar success stories of producing alternative low-cost electrocatalysts that they can be active for the oxygen evolution reaction and also stable in the acidic environment. And actually, to be honest, there are some electrocatalysts that they have been proposed in the literature, but their durability and stability, like in the long term, is still questionable. And the second thing, which is also of importance, is that this gives us the hint that we still have to rely on iridium, but the iridium availability is very limited for the moment. So actually, this limited availability of iridium hinders the installation of PEM water electrolyzers at gigawatt scale. And this was also discussed very nicely by Cyprien this morning, but I brought also here this slide. It's based on this reference of this year, which is a very nice one. And they saw the technology-specific iridium demand for PEM water electrolysis. So actually, this is the product of the iridium catalyst loading that you see here in the x-axis and the PEM water electrolysis capacity, power capacity in the y-axis. And the color, the contour color, the lines represent the levels of resulting iridium demand in tones. So here the red indicates large iridium demand, and as we go to the blue, this indicates less iridium demand. And based on the state-of-the-art iridium loadings and performances, it has been calculated that the PEM installation rate of 5 gigawatts per annum in the market ramp-up phase requires more than 3 tons per annum of iridium. And this is actually almost half of the estimated global annual iridium mining productions. So in order to cover the future iridium demand, two preconditions are necessary for a large-scale PEM water electrolysis industry. First, we need to develop catalyst systems which can have reduced iridium loadings but still sustain sufficient performance. And second is that effective recycling infrastructure has to be developed for iridium with recycling rates of minimum 90%. So today, my talk has to deal, of course, with the first point, developing of catalyst systems with improved iridium utilization. So now this brings me to the second part of my talk, and I will just make parentheses here to speak about the project's timeline and the manpower. Because I have the honor to be the presenter today, but this work has been accomplished with the work and dedication of many people. And therefore, I would like to give this to take a few minutes and speak about this. So I would like to say that SINGASCHEM, together with a group of me, of Dr. Tsambas at DIFAR, and together with Professor Peter Thune from the Fontis University of Applied Sciences, we are participating in RACPRO project, we call it ALMA project, together with the participation of Nurion and Dumicro. And the goal is to develop novel electrodes and membrane electrode assemblies for water splitting. And we identified from the very first beginning that it's very important to find alternative deposition methods. So in the meantime, SINGASCHEM at DIFAR were approached by VS Particle, and we were in contact with Aike, the CEO from VS Particle, and Aike was in principle at the time scouting about electrochemical applications of their spark ablation technology of deposition. So of course the technique attracted our interest since it aligned excellently with our ongoing activities of the ALMA project. And in this way the collaboration was established and various people were enrolled. So from the side of VS Particles, Wilbert and Sophia have undertaken the deposition of the samples, and then several students from the Fontis University of Applied Sciences worked in the project, and they were supervised by me and by DIFAR. And these guys focused on the electrochemical testing of the samples. So the project was not from the beginning successful, since we had to establish the appropriate method for preparing our samples. And this knowledge was established by the preliminary work of Isabel and Paul. And then once this knowledge was established, it was inherited by Case, who actually did most of the electrochemical investigations that I'm going to show today. And also the internship of Case was over, then Tone took over, and Tone is still working on this project. And then, of course, I have to mention Mark Lavorenti, a PhD student of DIFBER, who has orchestrated the efforts of all these funded students. And he has also worked on the preparation of samples for the morphological characterization. So now going to our approach and our new deposition technique, I will just take a minute to describe how catalyst-coated membranes for PEMGOTR electrolysis are prepared conventionally. So as you can see, the process is multi-step. So first, it's a multi-step process to start for preparing the catalyst. And then once this catalyst is synthesized, usually in a powder form, then a suspension has to be made and we call it catalysting. And actually we just mix the catalyst with appropriate elements in order to prepare this ink. And then we have to coat it on the polymeric membrane, either by spraying or by printing, which is then the film then is dried. And here you can see the resulted catalyst-coated membranes. So this overall process, apart from multi-step, it also involves the use of liquid chemicals in several steps, as you see. So we have to take into account also, apart from the time consuming, we have to take into account also the environmental impact of this process. So, as I said, it's very important to improve the iridium utilization, and the current strategies in literature to do this, to realize this, are focused on two directions. So the first idea, the first strategy, is to maximize the iridium dispersion using high surface area supports, for example, titanium oxide. And the second is to use alternative catalyst nanostructures. But all these strategies actually aim to make this catalyst better by means of having an improved iridium utilization. Here I'm just giving some examples for how these strategies look like. Here you can see, for example, iridium oxide nanoparticles on a porous titania substrate by the group of Professor Schmidt. And then you can see here, for example, nicely deposited iridium nanostructure thin films. And a more recent study the group of Peter Strasser, where iridium oxide nanofibers were used on top of a layer of iridium oxide nanoparticles. So as I said, all these approaches aim to tackle the problem by modifying the catalyst. And the challenge in all the cases is that once we're going to low iridium loadings, and specifically lower than 0.5 milligram per square centimeter, then thin and very inhomogeneous catalyst layers are obtained. While ideally we would like to have a relatively thick, but also importantly, homogeneous catalyst layer. And this, of course, this situation brings a lot of performance issues. And this brings very clear that new catalyst designs are required, which can enable the fabrication of homogeneous catalyst layers and low iridium loadings. And this is what our approach does. We're aiming to tackle this challenge, and we are introducing an alternative strategy. And for our case, instead of tackling with this catalyst synthesis, we just take another view on the problem, and we just introduce an improved catalyst layer manufacturing technique. So here you can see, I already described the conventional way of preparing a catalyst-coated membrane. And here you can see the deposition method that we proposed, of course, based on the spark ablation technology of this particle. So if we exclude the step of fabricating an iridium rod, which is, of course, essential to start the deposition, then the overall coating process is just one step, it's just a single step. So you can see in just a single step, we can have the catalyst-coated membranes. So this process, as I said, this single step, another important thing is solvent-free, which is good for the environment. It's very simple, as you saw, it's very fast. So this means that the production of catalyst-coated membranes is less time-consuming, of course. It's reproducible. It is also very flexible because it can take place on various substrates, and it's also highly controlled, as I'm going to show later. So I will now take a few minutes to describe a bit the technique of this particle. And the first thing has to do, the first process, let's say, has to do with the nanoparticle generation. So basically, an electric discharge is introduced between two electrodes, and this discharge locally evaporates the electrode surface, and then atoms are carried away from the plasma created by the spark discharge. And these atoms will aggregate into nanoparticles downstream of the spark. So importantly, by varying the residence time of the atoms in the reactor, this particle can control the particle size. Now, the nanoaerosol is generated by spark ablation of metallic electrodes, as I said, and the carrier gas transports these particles to their intended location. And the reactive carrier gases can also be used to form, for example, a metal oxide nanoparticles. So once these nanoparticles are generated, then their deposition on the substrates takes place, and this deposition mechanism is used in the print, which is used in printer of this particle, is based on inertial impaction. So using inertial impaction, the particles in the nanoaerosol can be locally deposited at room temperature and rough vacuum. And an additive manufacturing method was realized for depositing nanostructured layers on a wide range of substrates. So the technology is scalable to industrial volumes and can be used for any kind of substrates, either they are conducting or not. And here you can see actually how the deposition system looks like in real life. And here is the generator where the nanoparticles are generated and which is connected to the printer of this particle. And this operates, as I said, under vacuum. And this ensures that the nanoparticles are accelerated through a print nozzle. And they are deposited on the substrate, which is placed on an XYZ stage. And we use this technique to depose, to prepare catalyst-coated membranes, and we actually deposited several iridium catalyst layers on top of Nafion membranes. And you can see here that we did it for different loadings of iridium. And here you can see the top view same images. As you go to this direction to the right, the loading of iridium increases, and as you go downwards, you have a higher magnification of the same images. And what we saw in all cases is that we have very uniform and homogeneous catalyst layers. And of course, we wanted to investigate the thickness of our catalyst layers, and here you can see some preliminary images of cross-section SEM. Here it's a commercial membrane that we used as reference. Here I would like to mention that commercial catalyst coated membranes have an iridium loading of 2 mg/cm². And here, and as you can see, they have the thickness of this layer is around 8 µm. And here you can see the cross section of the BSP particle catalyst coated membrane with an iridium loading of 0.8 mg. And you can see that we have a very thin catalyst layer, 1 µm, and also that this the thickness is homogeneous. And we outsourced actually the samples to a private laboratory to have a better quality images of cross sections. This was of high importance for us. And actually they carried out the cross section with two different methods. So here, as you can see on your left hand side, at first, a small piece of the sample was embedded in an epoxy resin. And from this block, a mechanically polished cross section was made. And you can see here, this white line is actually the iridium catalyst layer, which you can see again, it's very homogeneous. We confirmed also the thickness also with this technique of 1 µm. And here is the second technique that they used, actually the cryofractured cross-section. The sample was immersed in liquid nitrogen and then was broken. And the cross-section was made, and here you can see again, the very homogeneous and very thin catalyst layer prepared by this particle. So, of course, we wanted to confirm the catalyst loadings because, as I said, we prepared the membranes with different iridium loadings based on the calibration of this particle. So we used a lot of various nominal loadings, And we wanted to confirm this, and that's why we used the ion beam analysis and the radar for the backscattering spectrometry, which is a technique that it's available at DIFR, and it basically detects the energies and amount of the backscatter ions from a solid target, which is then proportional to its concentration. And as you can see here we have the values of iridium loading estimated by RBS, and here is the nominal loading of VS particle, and you can see a very good agreement actually. So RBS confirmed the high level control of VS particles technology in the deposition. And team analysis was also carried out. This is still a work in progress, actually, but I just brought here two figures to show to you. A TEM image of a commercial sample, and you can see nanostructures, nanoparticles of 5 nanometer. And here you can see how the TEM image of a VS particle sample looks like, and we can have nanoparticles of 2 nanometers. So now we'd like to move and speak about actual results, and I'm going to show to you the activity of these catalyst-coated membranes during PEM water electrolysis. So as I said, a set of samples was prepared by VS particle for different iridium loadings. We knew the iridium loading from 0.2 to 2.4 milligram per square centimeter. As I said, we used a Nafion membrane of intermediate thickness as the substrate, and the commercial platinum cathode was used. And to compare our results, we used also a state-of-the-art catalyst-coated membranes with exactly the same cathode and exactly the same polymeric membrane. And all these membranes were introduced in a single-cell PEM water electrolyzers. And the activity screening took place at room temperature operation. And here you can see the polarization curves. Now, I know that this graph seems to be somehow busy, but I will guide you through this. So the different colors represent different loadings of iridium on the catalyst-coated membrane. And here, with the black symbols, you can see the results obtained with the commercial membrane. Here, I would like to remind you that the commercial membrane has a loading of 2 milligram per square centimeter. So what you can already see, for example, with VS particles samples, for example, with the 0.4 milligram per square centimeter, or even more interestingly, with the 0.8 milligram per square centimeter, is that we can have much higher current densities and actually much lower catalyst loadings. And now, to make this somehow more clear and more friendly to the eyes, we cross-plotted the current density that each of these samples is obtained with each of these samples under a constant potential of 1.8 volts. So we just recorded the current density at this potential, and we plotted versus the iridium loading. And here, with the star symbol, you can see where the commercial membrane stands. And as you can see, the current density for all the VS particle catalyst-coated membranes is actually higher. So this means all our membranes outperform the commercial. Just to remind you here, larger current density means higher rate of hydrogen production. And to use more descriptors, like to compare the activity for the samples, we used also a parameter which is called iridium-specific power density. So this is basically a descriptor that for the iridium utilization, and it indicates how much power and how much iridium loading is needed for achieving a specific hydrogen production rate. So the goal is to make this parameter as low as possible. So here you can see that we calculated the values of this iridium-specific power density for all our samples, and we cross-plotted this over the iridium loading. The target, of course, is to go to as lowest values as we said, because as I said, this direction indicates improved iridium utilization. And you can see actually that all our samples are very well in this direction compared to the commercial sample that is shown here. So basically, with the VS particle technique, this iridium-specific power density was drastically reduced up to an order of magnitude. And we used two more performance indicators to compare our samples based on the harmonized protocols for testing low-temperature water electrolyzers by the European Union. The first performance indicator is the energy efficiency, which is the amount of total energy required to split 1 mole of water under reversible conditions over the actual amount of energy used in the process. And the second parameter is the specific electricity consumption, which actually indicates the electric energy required to produce 1 kilogram of hydrogen. And here in this table, you can see actually a summary of the activity screening. I remind you, this activity screening was just carried at room temperature. So here on the top, you can see the results with the commercial membrane and then all the results that we obtained with the VS particle catalyst-coated membrane. And here is the potential required to drive electrolysis at a specific rate. So basically, we would like this to be as low as possible. So you can already indicate that these three samples with the loading rates between 0.4 and 1.2 were found to fulfill this criterion. Then here we have the energy efficiency, which of course we would like to be as high as possible. And again, if you compare with the commercial sample and the other samples, these three samples again appear to be the optimal. Then we have this standard electricity consumption, which we would like it to be as low as possible. And this again confirms that these three samples seem to be the most promising. And last, we have the iridium specific power density, which, as we discussed, has to be as low as possible. And then this gives us that the three samples with a range from 0.2 to 0.8 milligrams per square centimeter of iridium seem to be the most promising. So overall, and by taking into account all the criteria, we identified that the two membranes with the 0.4 and 0.8 loadings were the most promising, and we chose to continue with those ones for further investigations. So we took these samples with the 0.4 and 0.8 loading, and we measured the activity during pump water electrolysis at 60 degrees now to be more representative of the actual operation industry. And here you, with the black line, you can again see the performance of the black sample, of the commercial sample, and the blue and the red are the VSP particles. And I remind you, the lower that we go to this graph, the better is the performance of an electrode, of a membrane electrode assembly. So basically, as you can see, both of our samples performed better than the commercial by using much, much lower iridium loadings. And actually, the iridium specific power density is again decreased, as we would expect. So activity is, of course, important, and all these activity tests showed us that the technique of VS particle is very promising to prepare catalyst-coated membranes. But durability is also a very important factor in view of practical application. So for this reason, we really paid a lot of attention on durability investigations, and we actually followed three different protocols for investigating the durability. So starting with the first one, it's called the steady loading. So in principle, you can see the load profile here. We used the galvanostatic operation at 200 milliamps per square centimeter. And we were monitoring the cell potential over time in two test blocks. So the first test block had an overall duration of almost 95 hours. Then we had the resting period by 23 hours, and then a second test block of 42 hours. So starting with the test block one, we saw that the degradation rate was 0.05 millivolt per hour. And also between test block one and test block two, we had a small amount of irreversible potential losses of 20 millivolts. So now taking into account this degradation rate, and assuming a cutoff voltage of our PEM electrolyzer at 2.2 volt, then the expected lifetime of our catalyst-coated membrane is calculated to be 10,000 hours, which is actually sufficient for industrial operation. However, even though the expected lifetime of membrane electrode assemblies is calculated in this way in literature, as you can see, actually, this calculation depends on the cutoff voltage of 2.2 volts. And In real life, this cut of voltage actually can depend on the manufacturer of the PEM stack or the PEM electrolyzer. So for this reason, a new descriptor for the durability has been introduced lately, and it's called the stability factor. And now what is different is that this stability factor is actually a parameter which is now independent from the cutoff voltage. And we, of course, calculated the value for the stability factor for our catalyst-coated membranes to be 1.2 10 to 5 hours per square volt, which actually is in very good agreement with other catalyst-coated membranes used in literature and proven to be of interest for practical application. Of course, after this steady loading test, we again measured the polarization performance. The polarization data for water electrolysis. So here with the black lines, you can see again the results with the commercial membrane, and with the red color, you can see the results with our catalyst-coated membrane. Solid lines in both cases correspond to fresh samples. Dust lines to both cases correspond to polarization data after this steady-state loading test. So here I would like to say that, of course, both of the membranes of the catalyst-coated membranes, the performance of both was decreased after this steady-state loading test. Yeah, the VS particle membrane needed 48 millivolt more to drive water electrolysis at 200 milliamps per square centimeter. So this means here, while the commercial membrane needed 16 millivolt more after this steady-state loading test. But what I would like also to point out here is that the VS particle catalyst-coated membrane, which has also one-third of the iridium loading compared to the commercial membrane, still outperforms the fresh commercial catalyst-coated membrane even after this steady-steady loading test. So the second protocol that we followed in order to investigate the durability of our membranes, it's based on a dynamic load profile, and actually it's an accelerated life test. So this protocol has been developed from the group of Strasser, and has been developed for three electrode setups, and it's designed to actually achieve a maximum dissolution rate of iridium-based anodes. So what we basically did was to follow square wave voltammetry by applying a step of 50 millivolts followed by a step of 1.4 volts. Each step had a duration of 3 seconds, and we repeated that kind of steps for 40,000 cycles. And according to the people that developed this protocol, this protocol should lead to iridium dissolution that could represent more than 10,000 hours of steady loading operation. And here you can see the data that we recorded, the current density versus time during this cycling of potential, and you can see the amplitude of the current was decreased over time. And of course, what was important for us was to measure the polarization data of PEM water electrolysis before and after. So here you can see, again, with the solid line are the polarization data with the fresh membrane. And here this mixed black and red line shows the results, the polarization data after this accelerated lifetime test. And just for a comparison, I brought also here the data with the dust line after the steady loading test of 100 plus 40 hours. So as you can see, the two different tests affected the performance almost the same. So this brings us to the fact that iridium dissolution is the main degradation mechanism, of course not the only one. And the final durability test was based on a flexibility load profile, and this is basically an accelerated stress test. It simulates applications where variable power input is encountered. So this was based on the harmonized protocols of European Union, and basically we followed a stepwise increase of applied current and then followed by a stepwise decrease. Each of these steps had a duration of 15 minutes, and we followed 85 cycles of this pattern. Here you can see the profile of cell potential over time during these cycles. And of course, the interesting thing is to see the polarization data of our catalyst-coated membrane before and after. Again, with the solid line is the fresh membrane, and as you can see, after this accelerated stress test, we had only a minor performance degradation. So this brings me to the summary and future outlooks, the last part of my talk. So the key findings of our work is that we introduced a new method for the single-step fabrication of efficient and stable catalyst-coated membranes. These membranes were proven to be active for PEM water electrolysis. The iridium-specific power density was decreased up to an order of magnitude. They were found to be durable, expected lifetime of 10,000 hours, which is sufficient for industrial application. And also what I would like to say that our results are reproducible because for more than 10 repetitive experiments, we had only a 5% deviation. I would like to remind the benefits of the VS particle deposition method, which can lead to significant cost reduction in the fabrication of catalyst-coated membranes. It's simple and fast, it's user-friendly and can be automated. It's environment-friendly since it's solvent-free. It has control features since this particle can control the loading and the particle size. Reproducible, as I said, it's flexible since various substrates can be used, and it's also scalable. And of course, this is only the beginning. This is only the start, and there is a lot of room for improvement in performance. And this is a work in progress. We're working on developing more sophisticated electro design. And last but not least, I would like to mention that the performance of these catalyst-coated membranes was demonstrated as proof of concept in PEM water electrolysis. But actually, this deposition technique is applicable also to other electrochemical technologies, for example, for fuel cells, electrosynthesis, or batteries. And I would like to thank you all for your attention. Once again, I would like to thank all the people that had the participation in this work. And I would like to thank Sinfuel China and the Regional Instrument SIA and the RACPRO project for partial funding of this work. So thank you.
Thanks, Fontaini. Thanks for the elaborate performance testing. I think our slide is we would like to give one or two seconds questions. So please, if you have any specific questions you would like to ask now, raise your hand or unmute your microphone. And then we can think of the session before going on to Paolo. He will be our next speaker. In the meantime, I would also like to mention or express our thanks to Fontaini and Charles and the whole team for this terrific collaboration. I think for us as a young company, it's a very important milestone to show also that we can indeed simplify production and still increase the performance of those membranes. So we want to accelerate all of this work into other fields like fuel cell membranes, CO2 reduction, and also potentially nitrogen reduction, including the formation of ammonia, which is one of the biggest chemical compounds. Any questions? You're also able to put them into the chat. So one hand, Martin.
Yes, hi, I'm Martin. I'm a PhD student at UDEV. I have a quick question. I'm not an expert on PEM electrolysis, but I get that it's the goal to decrease the iridium loading. And like you showed a lot of interesting data, but one thing that I noticed was that the 0.8 was kind of better than the 0.2, right? Milligrams per centimeter squared.
Indeed.
Why is that, do you think?
Well, yeah, as I said, in order to find which are the best, the best layers, we used a lot of descriptors. So as I said, it was not only one thing, but it's a series of five descriptors. So yeah, in basically, yeah, just with the 0.4 and 0.8 milligram per square centimeters, I can assume that we have more active sites. So then that's good, of course, but then we have to speak about efficiency. So at some point, yeah, you cannot just go so low in the loading, at least in our case, or at least not with the present electro design. So it's not that this sample was not active. I mean, if you compare it with a commercial sample, because it has only the 1/10 of the iridium loading of the commercial sample, and this was still active, this is a great success, because this is actually, at least to my knowledge, the smallest iridium loading that has ever been reported to be applicable in femgotter electrolysis. So then the idea is, of course, that yeah, you have to go to low loadings, but you need also a lot of preconditions to have a good air electrode. So yeah, then we're just working also on optimizing our electrode design to enable also good performance also with such minimal loadings.
But so you haven't investigated yet why the 0.2 works less good than the 0.4 or 0.8, for instance, or is that what you mean?
Yes, we're just investigating how to make it how to make the efficiency higher also with that one. So I mean, if you see this, the iridium specific power density, so if we speak only about this descriptor, then of course it was the best of our samples, because it gave us an order of magnitude decrease in the iridium specific power density. So it's not that it was not active, because you cannot expect a sample with so low iridium loading to be as active as another one. So when you are speaking about the performance, you have to take into account the loading, but also the power input. So if we just take this descriptor, that was the best of our samples, and that was normal and to be expected, and for us it's a great success. But when you go to a system that is interesting for practical application, this parameter only doesn't say something, because you would like to have a system that operates with very good efficiency and to operate with very low specific electricity consumption.
I see.
Then you have to balance all these things, and then just this sample didn't appear to be yet optimal, but we're working, as I said, on its optimization.
Okay, I see. I think I probably didn't see like some of the other parameters that you discussed, so that I didn't quite understand the trade-offs, but you made it very clear right now. Okay, cool. Aike, do I have time for another question, or do we have to continue?
I'd like to give the stage to, there's one other speaker raising their hand, and then I would really like to move forward to the next talk of the session. Again, Martin, if you have any additional questions, you can just send the email to me, and I will forward it to Fontaine for some more specific questions. Also good to mention that there will be a full report of this investigation being published in the coming days, so that we can all read it in more detail with more background. So I would like to give to, I'm not sure how to pronounce the name, Tosha?
Oh, it's Lineker.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. So I'm Lineker from the University of Twente. My question regards basically the structure of this catalyst layer you made. You showed two SCMs, the one you've made and the one from commercial. And then the question is about leaching. If you have observed any leaching of iridium, I know that you mentioned this solution, but this should happen anyway. But about leaching, since the layer looks a bit thick, like dense, not thick, like even thinner, but dense, compared to the commercial one, if when you assemble your cell and you perform the test, if that's afterwards you saw any leaching of this catalyst layer made by this process.
I will explain. So what we have done to be sure before starting at all with BS particle, just prepared catalyst coated membranes, and we immersed them in water and just let them there in a beaker for several days, and the samples, like the films, were intact, so they were stable. However, after the testing, the electrochemical testing, we cannot anymore do any kind of such characterization, but this is also valid for the commercial sample. And the reason is that when we take these catalyst-coated membranes, then actually we clamp it between current collectors and the bipolar plate of the cell, and all these things just press together, and then it just comes one unity. So this means that after testing, I mean, everything is just all together, everything is just pressed together. So This means that when we're trying to disassemble piece by piece, of course, all the catalyst films are detached. But this is also with commercial samples. So this is just the way that PEM reactors are, because they you have to pressurize this whole membrane electrode assembly. But I think that I can answer your question just by saying that we did this as first step, the very first step, just to immerse them over a long period of time in water, and they were intact.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks, Fontaine. Thanks again for that clear answer.